I'll start off by saying that this story contains very little actual scares, but it's a tale that will never leave me, as it has rooted itself deep within my life and soul. Lots of people have something like that. An event that stirs within them from the past and goes with them until they themselves pass on. I guess my story is just another one of those, but really that takes away none of the impact it had and still has on me today. Here goes. When I was in primary school from grades 1 to 4, I had zero friends. I was just one of those kids who had a rough time making friends, didn't connect with people, etc. So those first school years I spent basically alone. Then a new kid came at the beginning of year 5. I'll give him a fake name, Sid will do, as in Sid Barrett. Anyway, whatever social problems I had at school, this kid Sid had at least like 50-fold. He would absolutely not talk to any kids, no matter who approached him. Teachers had it almost as bad when approaching him. If he was ever called on to answer a question, he would just mumble something, more to himself than anyone else, at which point the teacher would just move on. He was also absent for at least a third of the time he was at school. One thing he did do, however, was draw, and his drawings, at least to me, were like nothing I've ever seen before nor have seen since. They weren't like violent images or disturbing scenes or anything, but just depictions of, I guess, chaos is the best word, especially things that couldn't quite exist. A little bit like those pictures you see, like M.C. Escher, where the objects don't really make sense to the eye. It was like, this was how he drew people, animals, places, everything. It was astounding. The details in the pictures were just off, like it didn't make sense to have certain things in certain areas. I'm not talking random stuff like a cow with a cactus for a leg or something, just shapes and lines and forms where they normally are not in real life. All done in pen, too. Anyway, he had a real knack for the pen and paper. A lot of these illustrations of Sid's went unnoticed by friends, by teachers, as do most things, but I took note and I attempted to make it known to him. See, I used to be, well, I still am, an avid sketch addict myself. So one day I sat next to him and did my own little drawing and passed it to him. Without making eye contact, I felt him stir for a moment, and then 2 or 3 minutes and a flurry of drags of the pen later, I was seated apply sliding towards me. Looking down, I saw the same thing I had drawn, except in his quasi-signature style. I'd made first contact. So we started talking. I was almost proud of myself, not only for having made my first connection to another kid after 4 years, but also being the first person to reach out and receive a response from this clearly non-social kid. We talked a lot about music. He was really into Pink Floyd. Like, sometimes he would draw visual representations of some of their songs, e.g. Echoes of Time moving across sand from the 23-minute song Echoes. Like this 10-year-old kid had a music connoisseur's level of interest, knowledge of a 30-something-year-old band. It was mind-blowing. So by the time mid-semester came around, he and I were close. It was amazing to have this like-minded and like-skilled individual. We became each other's second halves. I actually felt bad whenever I had to stay homesick because Sid would be all by himself, as he was in the beginning of the year. He turned up on those days, that is. I can't imagine what his school life was like. It really seemed like I was his first friend. So he and I had that kind of kindred spirit thing going on. Pretty sure that's one of the main reasons we grew so close. But now third term, Sid had started to come out of his shell. He was starting to respond to other students. He was answering teachers' questions, and he was absent a lot less. Not to put myself on a pedestal, but I think his new interaction with the world was stemming from the fact that now he had someone. His brief aching loneliness was glaringly obvious in the way he would treat our relationship. One thing that remained weird was his parents. Rather the way he talked about his parents. Granted, this subject rarely ever came up between us. There was a kind of almost fear or maybe resentment Sid had for his parents. He always got really quiet when they were brought up. For example, whenever I brought up the notion of one of us visiting another at their house, he'd just say something along the lines of, "My parents don't like me being out of the house very much," or "My mom and dad really don't want anyone else at our house." He never knew why this was, and quite frankly, neither did anyone else. I never met them, and no one ever saw them outside school. They never turned up to any parent-teacher meetings, nor any school productions. Sid walked to and from school. I had begun to guess that Sid's parents had played a significant part in his personal problems. So it was because of this that I could never visit Sid or vice versa during the holidays in between years 5 and 6. Something happened to Sid during those months. I never found out what happened during that time, but it was fucking bad. In the start of year 6, Sid would turn up maybe once a month. When he did, he was a wreck. I mean, it was worse than when I first met him. He would be extremely anxious and hyped up, constantly looking at the windows, and when we were outside, looking into the distance. I don't mean gazing off into space. I mean literally scanning his surroundings for as far as he could humanly see. Other times he would be the opposite. He would sit there, not budge, to a point where he'd stop thinking for several minutes. Other times he would stare intently at some random student in the class, as if there was something underneath their skin he was trying to get a glimpse of. He goes back to his mumbling to himself incoherently. Naturally, it was highly concerning to me, his best and only friend. But no matter who I went to, my parents, the teacher, even the principal, nobody could do anything without permission from Sid's parents. We already established hard enough to contact, let alone work with. Then one day, towards the end of the first semester, something happened that will set it all in motion. This was the event where I developed a feeling in my heart and soul that there would not be a happy ending for my dear friend Sid. We're outside during recess or lunch break or whatever. He was sitting leaning against a tree, his head in his lap. I was sitting to the side of him, attempting to make idle conversation. As usual for that year, I received no signs of comprehension. Then something sparked within me, all the pent-up curiosity, all the questions I had about Sid's own personal life, coupled with my intense frustration at his essential disconnection with reality. I let him have it, scolding him and telling him he can't go through life like this, like he was. That all our time together and the progress he had made as a person in this world was all for nothing. As soon as my rant was over, despite him barely even acknowledging my presence, instantly regretted it. A few minutes later, he tensed up. I mean, it was so tight, several veins were showing in his face and neck. Then his head snapped up from its resting position. It was then that I got a good, proper look at his face. As pale as a ghost. I mean, I've seen blankets that weren't as white as his face right then and there. He had bags under his eyes, the purplish gray contrasting against his skin. His face was gone, and his cheekbones, jawline, and eye sockets were significantly more visible than they used to be. He remained in that position for several seconds. Right before I could begin an apology for my explosion, he took off and bolted towards the exit of the school, as faster than I think anyone had ever seen him move. To this day, I don't know why Sid looked the way he did. What was making him so goddamn erratic? Or where he went when he disappeared, or why. At that point in time, it was never apparent to me, although it should have been, that those scolding words to him would be the last thing I'd ever say to him. So I became determined to visit Sid at his home to confront both him and his parents. I decided that on the coming Monday, I would have my parents drop me off early at school under the guise of rehearsals for production. Find Sid's designated school diary, assuming it would still be in his desk. Hardly anyone took their diaries home like we were supposed to, and get his home address. but surprisingly got all that done successfully and made my way to his house before school began. It took me at least 40 minutes to reach his house. Sid had to make that trip twice a day whenever he'd come to school. The door was conveniently unlocked, almost suspiciously convenient, but I figured parents of a kid like Sid would do something like that. I didn't bother exploring the house. I just made a direct beeline for wherever Sid's room would be, if he even had a room, which he did, which I found on the first try. You know the scenes in a movie where a character discovers the body of another character? How they'll be either solemn or suspenseful music, or close-ups of the live character, and often obscure, tricky shots that hint that at the body that didn't quite fully reveal it? I didn't have that option. Sid's room was a barren excuse for a sufficient living environment for an 11-year-old. And there, splayed on the mattress in the corner of the room, was Sid, a thin, jagged red line running from one side of his throat to the other, rusty old straight razor in one hand, barely being held onto. His facial expression the same as right before he took off that afternoon at school. Most people I tell this story to, which is few in number as it is, assume that 11-year-old mind wouldn't be developed enough to quite fully understand the situation. And from what I remember, they're right. I just stared at what used to be Sid, my one and only friend, now inanimate amalgamation of organs and limbs. I remember being both physically and mentally numb, not comfortably as Sid would have it. I knew he would not be coming back, so I knew there would be no happy ending, no redemption, nor cure for poor Sid. You know, they always get the color of blood wrong in the movies. What happened between me exiting Sid's room and being interviewed by a detective was really a blur. As cliche as that sounds, a year later my mother would tell me that the parents had taken off untraced and untraceable. She would tell me of the strange, unidentifiable equipment that was found by police upon visiting the residence. She would tell me of the chains, assorted ropes that were found in a concealed storage room. She would tell me of the scratch marks, dents, holes, and other damage marks underneath layers of wallpaper on Sid's bedroom walls. There was no funeral for Sid. Upon some further research of mine, propelled by that not all which is entirely excusable and really legal, so don't tell, I would discover some deep, disturbing shit. Unforgivable, unbelievable, and abhorrent shit. The authorities did, in fact, have Sid's parents in custody for about a day and a half. During this time, a team of detectives, interrogators, and forensics and chemists worked to deduce the situation regarding Sid's family. His parents were members of an extremely obscure and secretive cult, considerably high-ranking at that. They were the group's alchemists. The cult's primary objective was to make contact with what the parents called it, which resides between spaces. I gave a real name for it, but trying to pronounce it might give me a stroke. Lots of apostrophes, very few vowels. The parents were determined to make contact using their skills in alchemy. A lot of traces of inexplicable chemicals and agents were discovered throughout the household. Naturally, experiments are meaningless without a test subject. That's where Sid came in.